Okay, so this is the final video. I've made a lecture mainly about reviewing the topics David Engelman talked about in his new LiveWired book. And I did a deep dive in some of the subjects that interest me as an AI practitioner. I'm a student here at Oregon State University, and I'm trying to get into a PhD program in computational neuroscience. In my undergrad, I did biology and chemistry in the hopes of doing pre-med. So this is perfect for me. As intersection of both. This is the third bit, right? This is the final part of this lecture. We're gonna talk about brain architecture search. I've kind of used that nomenclature to contrast this to neural architecture search and deep neural networks. So I call it brain architecture search because what does the real brain do for all these decisions that come up in neural architecture search all the time in deep neural networks? And while reading David's book, I took notes of like high-level concepts that he mentioned that do go into shaping your brain's wiring diagram constantly throughout life. And I've put them here. Experience, I think that one's not contentious. That should be a no-brainer. Attention, so what you focus on, what draws you in to really deeply analyze something, that's gonna shape the way your brain grows. Our goals, so what you find valuable, what you want to accomplish, that's obviously going to shape your brain, but also that's going to be tightly coupled with attention as well. And then approximately 7,000 genes, there's kind of two things in here. I wanted to keep the slides nice and clean, but obviously epigenetics is going to impact the way your brain wires. Epigenetics, if you're not familiar, is kind of a way to, like, you've got all this genetic material that encodes these little cellular machines. What epigenetics can do is to either make it so less of the cellular machine of each gene is made or more. And essentially they're just compacting it. So the replicators of that stuff can or can't get in there more easily, right? So epigenetics is implicit in here, but it definitely matters too. And where does the 7,000 number come from? Well, the Human Genome Project sequenced all of our genome and discovered, well, we've got about 20,000 allele or genes that encode for cellular machinery in us, in our whole DNA. And roughly a third of those, so about 7,000, are primarily expressed, or machines primarily built for and expressed in the brain. So let's dive in. I really like Tetris, and this is great because this paper is dealing exactly with Tetris, and coincidentally, the original paper was published in 1992, the year I was born. And what they did, found eight young men who'd never played Tetris a day in their life, and they injected them with this radioactive glucose. And while the glucose was moving throughout the body, right, getting everywhere, for about 40 minutes, they made these guys play Tetris for the first time ever. And then they stuck them in these scanners. And so at that point, their brain has used a lot of energy and is recovering from having just played Tetris and requiring all this attention to play good and everything. And the radioactive glucose is in there and not exploding, but it's decomposing and causing gamma ray light to be shot out through the brain. And that the PET scanner is this ring of gamma rays, cameras essentially, that allow to capture that glucose being decomposing. So essentially the PET scan allows you to get a rough estimate of the energy usage in the brain and quantify just how much energy was used by different parts of the brain. So the newbies here and the naive, this is just one individual, when they first played, man, their brain was lit up like a Christmas tree. They were using a bunch of energy to play this game. But what they did with these eight people is they scanned them in the beginning, and then like 6 to 8 weeks later, after daily training for about 40 minutes, they stuck them back in the scanner. And not only did during this practice, right, did they get like 10 times better at the objective of Tetris, but their brain still at the same time getting better used like 30 to 40, 50% less energy sometimes. So that's I think that's really interesting that the brain learns to rewire, but also, you know, this evolutionary need to be energy efficient also crops up as well while the brain is learning to rewire itself. Throughout the book, David Engelman talks in terms that kind of remind me of Daniel Kahneman's Thinking Fast and Slow, the System 1 and System 2 ideas. I haven't read this book, but I've heard it mentioned a lot in the culture I surround myself in. The idea is that system two is slow and conscious, meaning, so like, let's say I'm learning to drive a car. If you tell me to do something like, hey, turn on your windshield wipers, it's going to be slow and I'm really going to have to focus on what I'm doing. And, oh, well, remember, well, I got to press the brake, you know, and look up and what's going on. And the idea is that out of system two, over time, or sometimes even quickly, will be distilled fast and unconscious programs. So if you've ever learned to drive a car, you get really good at it and it doesn't require you to be so hyper-focused and attentive on everything. It's more automatic. Such that, you know, if you've got a friend in the car, you can even talk to them. You don't even have to think about the road consciously. So I'd love to hear what David thinks of this. Hopefully I'll get another opportunity to ask him. He never explicitly mentioned this, so maybe there are points where this breaks down. If you guys know or are more familiar with this line of work of Daniel Kahneman's, leave a comment. That'd be great. And last slide. This is a shame that neurotrophins and acetylcholine were put on one slide, let alone they didn't get their own. That's kind of an insult to these fields. They're very deep. And I don't know the whole things, but I did a dive and I tried coming back up with some true nuggets that us AI practitioners, and particularly the intersection computational neuroscientists who might want to build these systems exactly like they happen in biology, or just to be able to abstract away cleanly certain bits that don't need to be replicated. I'm going to use an analogy. Neurotrophins are kind of like fish food sprinkled in the tissue where neurons are developing, whether it's early in life or later in life. And this allows the right amount of nerve tissue to be generated. So you can have like a chicken egg, and there's a chicken embryo in there. And if you look at its arm, as it grows, it'll get more and more of this fish food put in it. And thus more and more nervous tissue is made. If too much nervous tissue is made, then there's not enough fish food and some cells will die. If there isn't enough neural innervation, there isn't enough neurons or axons, whatever growing out there into the new limb, then there will actually be a lot more fish food, a lot more neurotrophins. And the neurons can sniff it essentially and grow towards it. The other thing neurotrophins do is they're used in multiple different signaling pathways, and it's kind of this fine balancing between staying alive and killing yourself. So this is what PCD and anti-PCD pathways means. PCD stands for programmed cell death. This is where the fish food analogy kind of breaks down because neurons that don't get the neurotrophins will die, but they kind of commit suicide in a sense. It's not that they've run out of food. A neuron that would starve from lack of glucose, you know, sugar or ATPs, would look a lot different than what actually goes on. They've got this signal that's always waiting to cause the cell to kill itself, and the neurotrophins, if they're around in enough abundance, keep it at bay. So if you remove the neurotrophins, then this signal that's always been there, cascading, waiting to happen, will happen statistically, and it will cause the certain genes to get expressed that then lead to this cascade of killing yourself. It's apoptosis. We can see some examples of that here in A and B. This dark staining here is from the density of the nuclear material of your DNA getting so condensed that it turns black and light isn't getting through it. And the reason this is a problem is like relating to the epigenetics I talked about earlier. This is one of the tricks of epigenetics. If you want to control how much a gene is expressed, how much cellular machinery gets made of this part of your DNA, you can just tighten it away and then nothing can actually reach in there and make any sense of the information. That's one way it kills itself. You'd also have autophagy. So this just means like eating yourself. This doesn't look like a normal cell that's all compartmentalized and very ordered, but this is something that has just been had holes cut through it like Swiss cheese. Acetylcholine, that's the last bit we'll talk about. If to put a real short, right, it recruits more compute. And let's dive into that. So acetylcholine will turn on plasticity, which will allow the brain to change. Maybe different bits of neural tissue over here can be recruited for a new task. That's what I mean by plasticity. But it needs to be paired with something else. If you just have acetylcholine and you have plasticity, you need something like the dopamine signal we talked about in the last video to encode the direction of change. David Engelman brought up a great example with mice to show that these two need to be paired. If you have this group of mice and you knock out acetylcholine in half of them, and then you make all of them kind of jump through hoops for the next couple weeks to get food, the acetylcholine rats won't ever actually learn to do anything different to get the food, and they'll be still slow at it. Where like immediately the normal mice whose brain can change because they've got these acetylcholine tracks from the basal forebrain here like intact, those guys, the normal ones, learn almost immediately how to get the food faster and faster and faster. There's also experiments in owl monkeys shown that this acetylcholine and the reward yet again are coupled in dealing out different tasks and how much each task gets of the neuronal real estate. So if somebody's touching you and there's some sound being played, but you need to really focus on one because it's tied to reward, like maybe it's your job, the one that's tied with reward will get more neuronal real estate. And this isn't contentious, actually. The dive I did into this subject showed that this was shown in like 2000 and 2003 in owl monkeys by different research groups, and they actually had, in a sense, the experiment reversed, right? One was looking at touch and one was looking at audio. Okay, and that's gonna be it, guys. This is the lecture I prepared based on this book, and I hope you learned something new. If I got something wrong, leave an angry comment, reach out to me. Let me know what you want to see next. Thank you.